This presentation is not intended nor approved for use as a continuing education course for dental health professionals or a certification course for coronal polishing. So let's look at coronal polishing. The definition is the removal of soft deposits and extrinsic stains from the coronal surfaces of the teeth. So once again, the removal of soft deposits and extrinsic stains from the coronal surfaces of the teeth. It is not a prophylaxis. It is not a prophy. A prophy involves scaling, and we are looking at coronal polishing. In this presentation, we're going to look at the indications, contraindications, objectives and benefits, scope of practice in California, identification and etiology of soft deposits, deposit retention, and cleansing mechanisms of the oral cavity. So here we have a slide of a nice smile. Oh, there's some staining and some calculus. Maybe this patient could benefit from whitening, but generally it looks like a pretty healthy mouth, nice gingiva. Upon disclosing using a dye to make plaque visible, we see that there is lots of plaque at the gingival third, in the embrasures, missing quite a few areas. So using a disclosing agent for coronal polishing can be very beneficial for the patient. And then we see the benefits of coronal polishing, how shiny the teeth are, how clean. They probably feel very slick to the patient and they're aesthetically pleasing for the patient as well. Polishing indications would be prior to certain procedures, prior to sealants to remove plaque, maybe fluoride treatments, although these days our fluorides now penetrate light plaque on teeth, so there is not an absolute requirement to polish teeth before fluoride treatments, depending on your type of fluoride you're using. Maybe prior to a dental dam, just to achieve good isolation, cementation of orthobands and brackets, or prior to seating a crown and bridge case, or etching. When you polish only certain teeth, as in the previous procedures here, cementation, crown and bridge, etching, this is known as selective polishing, where you're only polishing certain teeth. And also sealants would be included in that. And definitely, if there's a presence of stain, polishing can be very helpful in removing the stain. Contraindications would be, well, of course, if there's no stain, or the patient has a caries present, or a high caries risk based on their dental history or their tooth structure. Maybe they have demineralized enamel or decalcifications, exposed cementum. If the patient's teeth are excessively sensitive, you can still polish, but you want to use a very light abrasive and be very careful about your technique. Newly erupted teeth still need time for calcifying, and so newly erupted teeth, again, they can be polished. It's recommended that polishing be delayed and that a very light abrasive is used for newly erupted teeth. Objectives and benefits. It does prepare teeth for certain procedures. It may improve oral hygiene. You see the question mark here. The current thought is that polishing is more of an aesthetic procedure rather than a required procedure for oral hygiene. Patients are used to polishing, so a lot of hygienists, DDSs still polish patients' teeth because patients expect it. But we know that it really is the scaling, the removal of calculus, that is what improves the oral condition, the oral cavity. It polishing may improve oral hygiene because the patient's teeth feel better, so they want to keep that hygiene going, or that feeling going. Slows formation of new deposits by removing plaque. And then, of course, as I said before, aesthetics and feels good to the patient. Okay. Scope of practice in California, coronal polishing is a duty of the registered dental assistant. Certification is required. And supervision, the doctor decides the supervision, whether it's general or direct, for the RDA. And please remember, it is not a prophy. Identification and etiology of soft deposits. So let's look at some soft deposits. The first one is acquired pellicle. And acquired pellicle is a naturally formed glycoprotein. Seconds after we brush, we have acquired pellicle forming on our teeth, and it does provide protection to our teeth. Another soft deposit would be plaque, and the constituents of plaque are the colonization of Streptococcus mutans, bacteria, saliva, sometimes food debris. If plaque is left on the teeth and continually forms for usually a couple of days, several days, then we call it materia alba, because it's heavy material, looks like cottage cheese. This patient either may not be able to brush because of physical impairments, or they just don't brush. And so we see materia alba. And then these pictures are really to be used in jest, but sometimes food debris does cause deposit retentions on the teeth. So what kind of deposits, or why do we have deposits? Excuse me, this is why we have deposit retention. Sometimes it's poor oral hygiene. People are just not brushing that plaque away and flossing that plaque away. Sometimes the diet has a lot of sticky foods, and so that can help or cause more retention of soft deposits. Calculus on the teeth, like huge barnacles on the teeth, cause irregularities in shape and therefore are a place where soft deposits can be retained. Fractures in either natural tooth structure or restorations have nook and crannies, really, for the plaque to stick to the teeth. If you have open contacts and or overhangs, that would be another area. This is open contact, where plaque would be retained very difficult, and if not cleaned, can cause a perio condition. Gingival hyperplasia, irregularities in the gingiva, also very difficult sometimes for patients to brush, and so there would be plaque retention or soft deposit retention. Oral habits such as mouth breathing increase soft deposit retention. If a patient has drug use, these are pictures of meth mouth, and they usually people who are addicted have a craving, another addiction to sweets, and of course they are so much into the high that they just don't take care of themselves anymore. So definitely plaque retention is a part of their oral hygiene condition, sadly. Xerostomia, or dry mouth, where the salivary glands are not producing or underproducing saliva, hyposalivation. If a patient has recession, then the cementum is exposed, and plaque sticks pretty readily on cementum. And they have a dry mouth, dry lips, and so all of that contributes to deposit retention. Let's look at cleansing of the oral cavity. There are some self-cleansing methods, mechanical methods, and chemical methods. So the self-cleaning methods of the oral cavity is saliva. Very good, it's, you know, watery usually. Somebody has ropey saliva, then this kind of goes against the self-cleansing mechanism. But along with the tongue and the cheeks and the palate, with saliva, able to move debris away from the teeth. Also the shapes of teeth. So most teeth have embrasures or curvatures, and so the shapes of teeth help, along with saliva, to wash soft deposits away from the tooth structure. Good old-fashioned brushing and flossing, whether you use a power brush or a hand type of brushing, along with oral hygiene aids, can cleanse the oral cavity. And chemically, there could be some mouth rinses. I have no affiliation with these two companies, just using them for examples. And you do really just need a small amount, whether it's toothpaste or a rinse. So in conclusion, we've looked at the definition of coronal polishing, removal of soft deposits from the teeth, remember, and stain, remember it is not a prophy, the indications, contraindications, objectives and benefits, the scope of practice for auxiliaries in California, identification and etiology of soft deposits, deposit retention, and cleansing mechanisms of the oral cavity. That is the end on the introduction to coronal polishing. I thank you very much and have a good day.